Good afternoon to all of you. Welcome to the last series of last session in the series of forensic odontology lectures and organized by Tirthankar Mahavir Dental College of Tirthankar Mahavir University and in association with the INPAFO and Association of Forensic Odontology of Human Rights. today, panelists. Dr. Emilio from Italy, Dr. Evi from Indonesia, Dr. Neera Taneja from India, and Dr. Ranjit Singh from India, Dr. Hemlata Pandey from India, and Dr. Gorya sir, the president of INPAFO. So these are all the panelists, and if you have the questions, already have been typed by the delegates, which have been sent to the email. And we are going to ask the source questions, and we are going to answer the questions. Sir, before I say that there are some highlights of our this series of lectures, and most of the people have given a message of good response of their series of lectures, and some of the people have messaged me that there was crystal clear presentation of all these lectures by the speakers. So there was no questions most of the people. But few people have got their own doubts, which is going to be clarified by the experts. And I thank to all the speakers who have been accepted our invitation and given a wonderful and very informative lectures online during, in spite of their scheduled time. So to start with, the first question goes to Dr. Emilio, sir. So now we have the lot of pandemic disease of COVID-19. So what are all the potential risks by the forensic experts during the death scene of investigations, in particular in cases of COVID-19? Hello? Shall I repeat the question? Hello?
Professor Emilio, can you hear us?
Dr. Emilio, can you hear us? Okay. I think there may be some network error. So, same thing, I request the same question to be answered by Dr. Evi. Ma'am, could you?
Can you?
Okay. The potential risk of by the forensic experts during the death scenes investigations in the COVID-19 cases, which is a pandemic disease. Or what are the potential risks which you are going to face?
Well, until now there haven't any research result about the potential of
risk. Okay.
The potential of the COVID-19 to the forensic personnel, but if we wearing the appropriate PPE,
okay,
it could be cover. It could be protected. But better.
To avoid the risk, the proper PPE kit has to be continue, has to be wear, and you have to, protocol has to be followed, and to avoid the potential risk.
Yes, right.
Can you? I think Dr. Emilio, if he's online, a question for to avoid contamination. Dr. Ranjit, Premila is not there.
I'm not able to see him.
Could you please repeat? I lost the line.
Yeah, Emilio is in.
Okay. Sir, I'll ask the same question. What are the potential risk factors by the forensic experts during the when you do the investigations in the COVID-19 patients?
What are the risks when you do a forensic investigation in which scenario?
COVID-19 pandemic disease.
I cannot understand the last sentence.
COVID-19.
Oh, I see. Well, until today, there are no
reports. COVID-19.
Yes, okay. Until today, there are no reports of having forensic experts infected during an autopsy. If you respect the protocols, if you respect the use of adequate and correct PPE, there is zero risk. Of course, it is important that you respect the protocols, like saying that you need to have you have to be fast, you cannot stay too much time during the dental autopsy, you need to reduce the time inside the mortuary. Also, we must work in three people. You need to have two dirty odontologists, let's say, that are around the human remains collecting the post-mortem data. And you need to have a third odontologist or eventually a dental hygienist. She will be or he will be the so-called clean operator that will help in recording the data. There are other issues related to safety and the PPE protections, which I cannot summarize in few minutes. But you are lucky because together with Francesco Lupariello and Emlata Pandey, we just published an article on Forensic Science International Synergy related to dental autopsy in SARS-CoV-2 positive cases, where you will be able to read all the best recommendations. As soon as it will be available in a few days, we will share this article to all the forensic odontological community.
May I like to add something here?
Of course.
Good afternoon, everybody. In the COVID-19 situation, we should take the crime scene investigation as a potential risk, and we should take all the precautions by which we can save ourselves and can save the members of our team. It is not only important that we save ourselves, we have to save those people who are at the crime scene. Maybe they are the persons who are doing the investigations, or may are the person, those who are helping in that process and are involved in it. For example, sometimes the police officials. So we have to take their help. As far as doing the autopsy is concerned, as far as the Indian scenario is concerned, we in India are at a, have a very few advantages here that we have to do it very carefully because the aerosols are being created when we are doing that dissection, and at that time all the precautions should be taken, as well as we are need to follow all the relevant procedures, and we need to take care of the relevant laws here in India. So whenever you are doing some investigation, please be careful and take as much as precautions and as far as many facilities you should use as are available. Thank you. Thank you. Please carry on.
Neil, sir?
Next question, maybe. Next question, please.
Sunil. Ranjit, sir, I think Sunil, sir, has gone offline. So you please carry on.
Okay. So the next question is related to that we have a common query from the different kind of participants, and all participants, they just want to know what are the career opportunity into the forensic odontology. So I'll request one by one speakers, like I'll request first to Emilio sir. He can give a view about what is the opportunity and what are the career scope in forensic odontology, and then it can be followed by the other speakers, Simbata Neeraj and Gorya sir, and Emilio, of course.
Okay, so I will try to answer considering my direct experience, but consider that every country has a different way of managing the expert witness registration in course. As I always say in my courses, first of all, a forensic odontologist must be a good dentist. So a forensic odontologist must have clinical experience and must be a well-trained dentist. Then, of course, an odontologist must attend all postgraduate courses that are relevant to the discipline. But in terms of a concrete professional, in terms of a concrete professional involvement, I strongly suggest that an odontologist must create contacts with the medical examiner's office, because in order to be involved in investigations and human identification, you need to have access to premises where there are autopsies. So once you are trained as a dentist, or you consider yourself sufficiently trained as a dentist, and after you have attended relevant postgraduate courses, which can be a postgraduate diploma in forensic odontology and in forensic sciences, a master degree, or even a PhD, but you can also attend workshops and short courses like the one that are organized by the American Board of Forensic Odontology or the International Organization of Forensic Odontostomatology. Once you have attended all these courses and you have also been trained next to a more experienced forensic odontologist, then you are ready to address yourself to a medical examiner's office and offer your services. It will depend, of course, on this issue, all the opportunities to be professionally involved, which will also depend on the judicial system, because I suggest then that you register to the court as an expert witness in the list of experts. The way you have to address yourself to as an expert in courts is country is different in every country, so I cannot tell you what is the standard. In Italy, you address an application to the list. It depends from countries to countries. But first step is to create offices and also create contacts with your training, your and also advise you where to do training and also courses that you can attend. So you have to be incorporated also in a network of association like AFOR, for example, where you can get directly information from other more experienced forensic odontologists and forensic scientists.
Yeah, I'll request him to add something in this about the Indian scenario, the scope of Indian scenario into the forensic, for the forensic odontologist, how they can develop their career in
Hello. Yeah, Ranjit, the question is for me. Yeah. Indian scenario.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can tell, sir.
Yeah. Yeah. As well. Yeah. As far as Indian scenario is concerned, any dentist can be a forensic odontologist. As such, as per Indian scenario, there are only two universities that are providing a typical specific course on forensic odontology. One is JSS Mysore, and another is a government university by Gujarat, Gujarat Forensic Sciences University. These are the two universities which are providing exclusive trainings on forensic odontology from the experts. Yes. Around few years back, Dental Council of India, there were discussion in the meetings of Dental Council of India that Masters MDS, Masters in Dental Surgery, should be started in forensic odontology. But due to lack of expert, this plan was shelved for few years. I hope they will start it now. But definitely what Emilio sir has said, that you have to have a training to be a dental expert witness in the court of law. Could be from IFOS or ABFO. I mean, just being a dentist, you have to be a good dentist before going into this field. But you have to be, you have to train yourself, you have to be perfect in that, because this is dealing with somebody's lives. This science is dealing with somebody's lives.
Right.
So Indian scenario, only two university providing.
I agree. So I'll request Gorya sir to add in this something.
So thank you, Dr. Ranjit. I will like to add in here that we have to take care of the law of the land. And in India, if it is a postmortem work, only the authorized persons who are authorized by the government, only they can do it. So it can be done only in the government sector. But as far as the clinical forensic odontology is concerned, like it is the age determination. So any registered dental practitioner or any registered medical practitioners, so they can do it, and there is no bar in it. But before one ventures into this, one must have an experience so that he is confident when he is doing this. For this, he needs to have some clinical knowledge, and then the second part is that he must have the skills in it also. For developing the skills, he must be associated with some person who is doing the work in this field. So for that, at present, as far as the concerned, it is only in the government dental colleges and the government medical colleges this work is going on. Yeah. So it is preferable that you can go there, you can request the head of the department, and I think they will always allow you. But if it is not possible, then you can go through the government channel, and they will always allow it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Himrata madam, I just want to if you can add something in this. If a person who has completed their MSc in forensic odontology from GFSU or from the JSS, so how the person can approach any authority or any hospital or any laboratory, because as per my knowledge, none of the laboratory forensic science laboratory, they have the forensic odontology unit. If they have, you can add in that how they can post their master degree for making their career as a forensic odontologist.
Unfortunately, forensic odontology is in India, it's stuck between forensic science and forensic medicine. So we are in a catch-22 situation. I am aware that many students have, because out of interest for this subject and out of the passion, they have gone and done MSc's in the universities which Neeraj sir mentioned. And now what has happened is, unfortunately, because this is not recognized by the Dental Council of India, the Dental Council of India doesn't recognize these MSc's. The Dental Council of India is not, and because all medical and dental colleges will employ people only who have recognized degrees by the NCI or DCI, by Medical Council of India or Dental Council of India. They don't care if they are UGC recognized. So that is a big problem these students are facing. So again, the DCI has to do something about this. The Dental Council of India, which is the authority body, they have to allow people or recognize some of these courses. And besides this, sir, I would say that as Gorya sir said, he's right about it. Only government colleges do medical legal work, and even in government colleges, again, there are so many issues because it is legal work. There are confidentiality issues related to the investigation, and they might not allow just an outsider who is not an employee of that institute to come and be a part of the team or come and observe. And so that is another problem we are facing. I would say that since we are now so many who have these qualifications, who have already trained, so we could together approach DCIA and request them to do something about this. Again, as Neeraj sir said earlier, there were no, very few experts who were qualified or trained. Now we have so many, so we can approach DCIA, I guess. And I'm sure the GFSU administration and JSS administration are doing something about it, of course. So I think for students, they have to be realistic, first of all, because when, sir, I went and I did forensic odontology around 12 years back. So at that time, sir, students have become very smart now. They think, mujhe kitna salary milega ye course karne ke baad, mujhe kaha job milega. They think about that, which is very good. I was stupid. I didn't think about it when I went, because I was so in love with this subject and I wanted to just learn. I went and I did it. So students have to be a little realistic. Ye India mein hai ki dentists feel that we can make this a full-time job. If you see across the globe, there are very handful, of people who are doing only forensic odontology. They are all dentists. They have their practices. They work in hospitals as oral surgeons, orthodontists, endodontists. They already have their career, or you can say their income or bread and butter from somewhere else. And everyone is doing forensic odontology as a passion because they are passionate about that subject, not to make money out of it or not to think that, how much I will profit from it. So I think there should be some realistic. Personally, when students ask me, I always tell them that go for MDS first. If you want to set up your clinical practice, it's fine. You can be a BDS and do clinical practice and be a forensic odontologist at the same time. But if you want to get into academics or you want to have a job in any dental or medical college, it is important that you do MDS. It is the true reality, because even if you're interested in forensic odontology and you're doing fellowship courses and you're doing MSc in forensic odontology, the dental college or medical college will only employ you if you are MDS. So I always tell students that don't do a mistake which I did. Learn from my mistakes. It is very important that if you want to be employed and in a medical college or in a government college, you will be needing MDS degree. In spite of, if you have PhD also, you still need MDS. So that is very important. That is just my two cents on this topic based on the experience I have had in India.
Thank you, madam. Gorya sir wants to add in this something.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Ranjit. So I it is very correct, as Dr. Hemlata has said, that we were the passionate people who started with all this and reached at the present stage where the people get interested in doing forensic odontology. But to move ahead, there are two ways. So those of us who are in the government colleges and sitting in the audience, and they should do like this, that they should establish a forensic odontology unit in their colleges. Once they establish the forensic odontology unit, they can get the post sanction for the forensic odontologist. And then they can have their own way that what qualification this forensic odontologist should have. Till the time that we have the regular MDS in the forensic odontology, they can say it is a BDS or MSc forensic odontology. They can say it can be MBBS and a forensic odontology, MS in forensic odontology, or like anything. Like there is a one college at Delhi, I am not remembering the exact Maulana Azad Medical College, where they have a forensic odontology unit, and they have employed one girl who is a BDS and who has done the MSc. and that is the way of starting it. The other side of the thing is that all of us should go for that. First, we should start a postgraduate diploma, and when postgraduate diploma becomes successful, we should go for the MDS in forensic odontology. I have met and talked to the president of the Dental Council of India, and they said that we are very open to it. Let somebody should give send us a proposal that we want to start a postgraduate diploma in a dental college or a postgraduate degree in a dental college. But still, for no college has come forward who can start this. So those who are sitting in the universities are those who are. It is easy for them. They should go and get the permission from the Dental Council of India, and that are the two ways which I think we can take it forward, the forensic odontology in India. As far as other countries are concerned, probably they have got their own ways. And for doing the post-graduation, you can go to the Leuven, you can go to the Leuven, or you can go to the Australia, or you can go to the Nepal, where the forensic odontology is being taught. And you can get a proper degree from there. And when you come back with a proper degree, you can approach the government and can say that we are trained in this, we are having the knowledge, skills, and aptitude for this. And probably then that will make a sense that new post will be created somewhere or the other.
Yes, sir.
And the third thing probably is in the forensic labs where they can definitely take the MSc forensic odontology people. Maybe they are the BDS or the forensic science or of the MBBS. And with gradual, when they will be exposed to this and they will have experience, then that will also carry value. So that is my opinion. Thank you very much.
I'd like to continue with
one more thing. One more thing I would like to add, very important point. DCI might not recognize MSc of JSS or GFUS or any other foreign degree as of now. But if you approach to the Home Ministry of your state with your degree and credentials, they might allow you. They have already allowed Dr. Ashit Hajare as well. He's trained from Australia.
Sir, Dental Council of India has recognized Ashit Hajare sir's degree. Diploma.
Sir, in this I like to
that ask. University particular case Dental Council has allowed that, but in case Dental Council if doesn't even allow, you can approach the Home Ministry. They sometimes allow that. This is what.
In this I like to add. See, the bylaws of the Dental Council of India is something different than the forensic science and forensic odontology. Forensic in India, it is dealt by Directorate of Forensic Services, DFSS. So, and Medical Council and Dental Council. So, forensic odontology is lying between the Medical Council and the Dental Council. And similarly, it is happening to the many medical colleges. So, here in a 2017 February, there was a meeting with the Home Minister Rajnath Singh, and we given a proposal that why not to form a Forensic Council of India, and which is already discussed into the Perspective Plan of the Forensic Science 2010 of the Ministry of Home Affairs. And in that, it is clearly mentioned that Forensic Council of India should be formed. And that document is available on the internet. So even Gujarat University, they have approached to the Ministry of Home Affairs along with a proposal, but it is lying in between. So when the Forensic Council of India will like form, so then there is no need to recognition from the Dental Council of India, because the degree is MSc in Forensic Science. While the Dental Council of India is recognizing degree of the BDS and the NDS. So if the Forensic Council of India come into the force, which is already with a ministerial process and it is already in the Perspective Plan of Home Ministry in 2010, then definitely these students can be employed in a several forensic science laboratory as a unit in a maybe in a medical legal section, and also our independent unit of forensic odontology can be opened.
I'd like to add something. The Gauriya sir, what he said that key regarding the Dental Council of India. The Dental Council of India already planned and framed the certain things to be the subject of a separate degree or a diploma course should be started in the heading of forensic odontology. And they have planned it, and it has been it is in the process of doing that. And they planned for the one oral medicine and radiology expert and one oral pathology expert. And the forensic odontology persons has to be trained, and the separate degree they are planning to form. So probably it is in the process. So maybe in future, that ECI will come out with some more guidelines regarding in the highlight of forensic odontology.
Yes.
But I would like to add it here, if you permit me, Dr. Ranjit.
Yes, sir.
That whether you are MBBS, whether you are BDS, and if you are in a government job, the people there, the medical legal cases coming are coming there, and they are dealing with it. And court has never objected to it that why an MBBS is giving an opinion, why a dentist is giving an opinion. So they will consider that opinion unless the person can withstand the cross-examination in that case. So if that cross-examination, if the person can face and he gives the opinion and he has experience, because we have been giving, we were not forensic odontologists at that time when we started. We were just MD in forensic medicine, and many cases of forensic odontology, like age determination, like injury cases, and even in the postmortem cases where the identification was concerned, we were all dealing with this without any degree in forensic odontology. So it doesn't matter to the court. The court, the person should be confident that whatsoever opinion he is giving, that will withstand the cross examination, and that will withstand the science prevalent in those days. So this will be good. So yes, we should not be afraid that we are not having that degree.
Absolutely.
And all that. We should have an ambition. We should have a passion, and we should work for it. And the court usually goes through that. But it will be very preferable when the postgraduate degrees will actually start in it.
Yes, sir. In this, I like to add another question I like to answer here. Few students or participants, they have asked that how we can start our career as a private forensic science expert. So, in our Indian Evidence Act, nowhere it is written that a government expert or the private expert. So, under Section 45 of the Indian Evidence Act, anyone who has the competent degree and the competent knowledge, they can start their practice into the forensic science field as an expert witness, and persons should be confident to appear in the court of law with their degree and with their knowledge, so that they can defend their report or the finding into court of law with the scientific fact and the scientific parameters. As far as the forensic odontology is concerned, in cases of the forensic odontology was taken by the states, means a police authority. Even a police authority can approach you, because the police manual said that you can approach a forensic laboratory or the forensic expert or any expert of the foreign knowledge. So that expert having a scientific knowledge, it can be a private forensic odontology. So you can approach to your nearest police authority, higher authority, and if they need your help, they can take you on a panel with their procedure. Because I am being a private forensic science laboratory, I am doing a work for the several police agencies. So the procedure is that they took me on a panel as an expert by their higher authority permissions, and by that permissions, they allow me to do the examination, and after examination, I submit my report, and then they submit that report on the basis of police, like as a prosecution. So in a private sector, if you have the knowledge and the analysis tools laboratory of the forensic odontology, you can approach to the police authority, and police authority, if they want, they can take you on a panel, and you can form an opinion for the police authority for being a private expert. If I am wrong, madam, or anyone can correct me.
So as far as
Ranjit, you just said that Indian as per Indian Evidence Act, anybody with a competent degree. Now, what do you mean by that degree? Is it like for forensic odontology or forensic degree or forensic odontology? What does evidence? Is it Evidence Act clear?
Sir, the person having the knowledge of the subject, like the competent knowledge of the subject. I did not say the degree. A competent knowledge of the subject, a master in that subject, those who can appear as an expert witness.
So here, can I will like, here I will like to add, I will like to add that if it is a clinical forensic odontology work, anybody with a degree, which is a registered degree, can do it, and nobody will question it. But as far as the postmortem work is concerned, only those persons who are authorized by the government they can deal with this. Even they are registered, they all the MBBS doctors can't do the postmortem examination. Only those doctors who are authorized, they will be able to do the postmortem examination. Similarly, they will be the similarly for the forensic odontologist. Those who are authorized by the government, they will be able to do this.
Correct, sir. Professor Emilio wants to add in this.
One more suggestion that could be an idea, because in terms of training and competencies, one of the aspects that the forensic odontologist must also acquaint during the education is also law and rights. So I suggest that if you have time, like me, you take also the degree in law. I am a student of a law degree. I have a few more exams to go. It is important that the forensic odontologist also achieves a degree in law. Of course, that's another issue. It's not related to odontology, but it's related to rights, protocols, norms, and laws. And this is extremely important, because our role as a technical expert is within a judicial system. And we have to know what is our role within that system. So I suggest for those who are interested and have time to also spend some time in studying law, or even taking the degree in law.
So here I would like to add something that maybe it is a good thing and relevant in the other countries of the world. But as far as India is concerned, either you can practice medicine, or you can practice dentistry, or you can practice law. Simultaneously, you can practice law and medicine, as far as my observation goes.
Yes, sir.
It is like that. You can't practice both, but to having a knowledge of anything, that is good, as suggested by Dr. Professor Emilio.
No, I didn't mean to practice law. I meant to take the degree in law. You can take as many degrees as you want.
Yes. That is not a problem.
It takes time, but in fact, if some colleagues from USA, they are DDS, Doctor of Dental Sciences, and also JD, Doctor of Jurisprudence, and this is something that we should also consider.
Correct. So I'll request Dr. Sunil to take other question, which is for the panel.
Question goes to Dr. Evi. Ma'am, in your presentation, you spoke about the antemortem and postmortem records and their importance and the comparison and etc. If you sometimes lost of antemortem records and you have only postmortem record, how do you manage whatever difficulties you will face in the identification?
Well, the first is the forensic pathology and forensic odontology working in a mortuary is to take the record of the dead bodies and human remains. And the second is, if there is a report on the missing person, we can do the comparison and then we can release the identification. And it means the positive identify positive. But if there is no data that we can collect from the missing person, we cannot do anything. But if there is no data, actually we can take from the last is the DNA. So the parents coming to us, and then maybe from their personal belonging, they have the epithel of DNA of the missing person, such as the brush, the toothbrush, or the comb. They can bring it to us, or the sandals. Or the shoes, we know that this person using that and nobody using it, so we can take the DNA from that, and then we can compare to our postmortem report. Or the second is, we took the paternity DNA, we took from the parents, and then we can do the calculation of probability of the result from the DNA of the human remain of the human bodies to this paternity DNA we get, and then we will calculate the probability of the DNA, how much it match. If it is about 99.99%, then we can release that person is the child of the parent itself. So that's the point. First is, we have to make more data, the antemortem data, as much as data we can compare. And the last one is the DNA. But for Indonesian, if you are 17 years old, it's quite easy because all of us should have a fingerprinting database. So it's more easier for us, for Indonesian.
Definitely, ma'am. Your country is following so many norms and taking fingerprints and eye scans and all the thing has been recorded at the data. Sir, in continuation of this, I'd like to ask Professor Gorya, sir, we are actually in India. There are many regions, according to my knowledge, there are many people and many of my students have done the many of endemic studies of the bite marks, lip prints and etc., all those things. And the data has been collected. We don't have any centralized data of these areas then, so that we can use it for some cases of emergency for the identification process. Sir, can you share something about the data? Can we have a centralized data, something like that, sir, from our association? You can take any association.
Yes, definitely. This is a good idea. We can have the data, but as far as this is concerned, there have been very limited number of studies. And for starting the data with a population of 130 crores, probably the data is in thousands. And that is also of the volunteers. And most probably the volunteers which are being there, they will never be involved with the crime because those are all the highly educated people who usually post of the volunteers what we are taking. Yes. So, but we have to start from somewhere. And if somebody can think about it and start with it.
Sir, can we have multicentric studies and multicentric centers in all of the, we are the people at least to start with from three countries, Indonesia, Italy and our India, with the same topic in the multicentric protocol and multicentric centers, so that the data can be collected in one point.
That is a very good idea, and I hope that gives us a way of thinking that how we should do it. So let this be put in PAFO meeting, and we can think about it that how we can proceed further for that in India.
Yes. Sir, question for Dr. Neera Taneja. Sorry, you can continue.
Yes, sir. Indian Association of Forensic Odontology has started this around 5-7 years back. But as sir said, this is volunteer. So after signing the confidentiality agreement with the association, doctors are submitting their OPGs, scanned OPGs with the association to create a national database. So their plan is that once they have 2 to 5 lakh of OPGs, they can convince the government to include that in Aadhaar or something like that. That's what their plans are. So in PAFO also, we can work on that in next EC.
And the question for you, Dr. Neera Taneja, and you spoke about the excellent presentation on the bite marks and everything. See, I'd like to ask you that these are the lip prints, bite marks, patterns, and all those things. A lot of studies has been conducted in India. And most of the budding postgraduates or the people have completed, they have the data, everything. So how far this helps in a legally? Is it have any strong evidence which helpful in the court of law?
Sir, court of law, that works on case-to-case basis, sir.
Okay.
They don't work on data system, as far as my knowledge is concerned. Case-to-case making means once we do, then this bite mark and limb print, they are based on assumptions. And this uniqueness of the dental teeth among the individuals. So this assertive, how it is transferred and recorded, that works with the court of law, sir. And how expert, how you stand the cross examination in that. Yeah. The data collected by many people in and around. Yeah.
There are a few cases already in Nirbhaya case also. Bite marks makes a very important evidence. Yeah.
Nirbhaya, there's one more case that Dr. Hemlata cross verified in the court. I think that was in 2017. But the point is that this science has been questioned in the nearest future, especially after Keith Howard case in Innocence Project. Yeah. But that this science is not a bogus science, as been claimed by them. But this is it's amazing science. Only thing you have to be expert in that, and then stand the cross examination. There are great chances, and many cases have been decided on this, and not only one, like Keith Howard case. That's okay, that happened there. Unfortunately, had to spend 33 years in jail. But that's up to the court to decide. We as an expert can give our opinion.
Yeah, I agree. Thank you. The question for Dr. E.V. Madam, you said in your presentation the photography makes a lot of an importance for that. You will take multiple photographs and to study and investigate. So can you share some experience on the photography? Why photography is more important in the part of an investigation?
Yes. First is when I read the question is about the Palu. The Palu, yeah. the earthquake and tsunami. Yeah. Tsunami cases, disaster. We took as much as picture as we can because we don't have time to do all the examination. And when we do it, the question is how many visual of identification we can do. So actually the visual itself can be 70%, but it's only not the only the face, but the characteristic of the person itself and the shirt and everything and the shoes. So we doing that it was a secondary identification. So if there is two to three secondary identification is positive for the family, so we can release the body to the family. So if you ask me how many percent of it, the visual is about 70%, the dental is 85% to 90%, and then the DNA is 99.90%, and then the last is fingerprinting, is 100% for fingerprinting. So it's the best. So that's my answer. I hope the question.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, definitely, ma'am. Definitely. Thank you. Dr. Emilio, can you say something on the photography as a part of the identification?
Well, it is extremely important that we don't rely on visual identification. Okay. Although visual identification has some applications in the using photographs, as experts, we cannot support this method. We must support best practice in human identification, which means best application of protocols and scientific methods. In order to do a positive identification, we must rely on fingerprints, DNA, and dental data. We cannot do an identification using visual recognition. Of course, there are some exceptions. There are some exceptions in local cases, in circumstances where you have all information and evidence of the identification. But beyond some specific and few cases, when you want to do a positive identification as an expert, you always have to apply these protocols. Even if the case is simple, even if the case is straightforward, you have to apply protocols. This is one of the strict rules of being an expert. You either apply the rules or you don't. You cannot apply the rules when it is better or it is easier. You apply all the rules in best practices, which in this case are fingerprints, DNA, and dental. Of course, you can have a positive ID using only a primary identifier combined with a secondary identifier. So you can have a positive identification using only fingerprints data or only DNA or only dental when these identifiers are combined with other secondary identifiers. Let me remind you, secondary identifiers are tattoos, personal belongings on the person, worn on the person, like watches, necklace, earrings, scars. These are other features, including some facial features. But again, we strongly are against the use of only visual recognition as a tool for human identification.
Thank you, sir. Sir, question for you next continuation. Sir, I've come out to many of the literature on the footprints. and they have done many studies, has been many research work has been done on the footprints. So how far its footprints is reliable in helping of the investigation? Hello,
is it to me?
Yes, sir.
Oh, sorry, I was reading
yes,
a message. Could you repeat the question? Sorry.
It's a question for you, sir. So there are, in my experience, I have gone through the many of the studies like fingerprints and dermatoglyphics and footprints. So a lot of literature has come out recently. Many articles are published on the footprints, and it is say that it's one of the real marker. It will helps in a positive identification. Well, can you share your experience in the footprints because you come across?
Okay. The human identification process is a process where you compare antemortem information of a person who is missing with the postmortem data of the human remains where you are doing an autopsy. Now, of course, there are primary identifiers, as I said, but the human identification is also an investigation process where you can rely also on other data. So all those identifying features, which can include, of course, also secondary identifiers and also footprints, lip prints, palatal rugae, even ear features. There are several features that are personal, that are useful and can be used for human identification. This process of relying on all these secondary features will depend on the case. Of course, if you have cases where you don't have primary identifiers from the site of the antemortem, you can rely on other methods. For example, facial approximation is one of the other features. For example, there are so many other techniques that can help in the human identification process. Of course, this is why we have to have a wider training and experience also in these other tools, other methods, because we have to consider all the identifying features of a person. And this is why it can be used, but of course you have to have also prints from the other side. And I believe that Dr. Ranjit is the best expert on this side of foot and hand prints.
Dr. Ranjit, can you add up anything?
No, it is already explained by the Professor Emilio. So I want to add two questions to the Professor Emilio because he has a time to go to the hospital. So two questions. Yeah. One is that regarding the new scale with color code device, have you seen any difference in healing process in form of color change or bruise in soft tissues on body and the same around the bite mark? That is the number one question.
Yes, we have been the colorimetric scale was actually developed exactly when I was doing an assessment on a bite mark lesion, because the forensic pathologist wanted to understand from my consultation if the bite on the victim happened in the same time of the stabbing of the victim, in order to establish if there was a time connection. I entered in this analysis of the color of the bruises. And in fact, the color of the bite mark in this specific case was not of the same time of the homicide. So that's why the colorimetric scale can really help in the interpretation of the time of the bruise, because sometimes you are asked to assess if the lesion is of the same time of other lesions. And this is extremely important in several crimes, including child abuse.
Yeah, the second question is continuing that, how teeth can be a convincing evidence if we are collecting through the selfie or software application developed by you?
So what are the opportunities, Ranjit?
How this evidence can be how much this evidence can be convincing for the court of law?
Okay, we are not relying only on this evidence. When we start working as an expert in a human identification case, from one side, you have the forensic odontology assessment. You have the dental autopsy, which is, of course, a technical aspect. On the other side, you help in the collection of possible identifying data and features. And you can do this performing just like a detective, which goes on social media and to search for portrait pictures, or you can help in the collection of portrait pictures, selfie pictures from the families of the missing. The idea is not to perform an identification using selfies. The idea is to narrow the search by collecting data, pictures, which can enhance and help in this narrowing process.
Yes. The question is for Dr. Hemlata, madam, and EV ma'am, collectively. Please.
Ranjit, excuse me, can I just greet you because I have to leave?
Yes, sir.
I thank you again, all the colleagues, all the organizers. It was an extremely experience. We'll be doing more, I'm sure. Enjoy the rest of the day, and I speak to you soon.
Yes, sir. Thank you, and thank you for your accepting our invitation. It's our privilege and honor. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes.
It was for me as well. Bye to all.
Bye.
Ciao, Amy.
Ciao.
So, the next question is for jointly for Dr. Yu and Dr. Hemlata. Please specify the age estimation technique followed in different laboratory for the different age category, such as children, dead as well as the living men. What quality assurance steps follow for the age estimation? If you want to read the question number is 25.
I think I already covered a lot about it in the talk. 2 days back, when I did my webinar, I spoke about age estimation and the different techniques which we can do in children or in adults. So obviously during the growing years, when the teeth are still developing and still mineralizing, we can use techniques which study the mineralization pattern, or which study techniques such as the Atlas technique or the Demergian technique, where we are observing the different stages of growth. And in adults, obviously, because the growth is completed, then we start seeing the secondary changes which happen once the growth is complete. So the deterioration, such as the secondary dentine deposition in the pulp chamber, which causes the pulp chamber to shrink. So the ratio of that pulp chamber to the ratio of the tooth, again we use that in adults. So there are, according to the case, we will use different techniques. Even for the pulp tooth ratio technique, we have different researchers published who have published different papers based on the different teeth they studied and the accuracy of these different teeth. So it will depend on a case-to-case basis. There is no hard and fast rule that I will use this particular study in all the cases. It will always be on case-to-case basis, whatever is available. Another point I would just like to add, which was from another question related to age estimation, that whether we as dentists can give an age estimation certificate or an age report. So I just would like to point out that no, you cannot give a solo report or of the age estimation, because you are doing just dental age estimation. There are many other aspects to age estimation. So there is always an expert panel wherever age certificate is given, and the panel includes radiologist, a forensic medicine expert, or sometimes someone from the orthopedics department, or even gynec in some cases. So
a dentist is a forensic odontologist is a part of that team, and you deal with the dental age section of that form. So the whole form, it has a section or a page for dental age, and you are the one responsible for that. The conclusion, the age at the end is always a total of all the reports from input of all the experts. So it also depends on the ossification, hand, wrist, joints, depend on what age range it is, the pelvis, all those things. And if it is an elderly person, we will observe the sutures. So it depends on the age range. We will use different techniques. And it is always the expert panel who will give the age certificate. And a forensic odontologist alone cannot give the age certificate. He will be part of that expert panel because it includes so many things, even the physiological changes in the body, the Tanner staging, it will be seen in adolescence. So all those things are seen. So it is always in a team we give an age certificate. So, over to Dr. Avi if she wants to add something.
You want to add anything?
Yeah, actually, I'm so much agree. based on my observation of maybe from the student or from the graduate thinking that actually we are the medical, we are the expert, but we are not making it one box to another box. We are working in square, but we are having working is comprehensive way. It's a holistic way. Then if there is a victim or there is a questions of one person age estimation, we have to do that the comprehensive examination on it. As a forensic pathologist, we are the doctor. We can learn about the puberty, the maturity signs of the person. And then for the forensic anthropology, we can see from the head to toe where we can measure the age estimation from the skull, from the hand, for forensic radiology, and then from the teeth, the dental, and also the pelvis and everything. So the whole body, we have to make the estimation of the person as the whole person, not only the teeth. But if it's only the teeth that we can get, so we're using so many methods. Estimation on it, and then we can, our conclusion is about the average of the person. So it depends on what it's going to use for. Like as in there is in Indonesia, my case is with Dr. Atmaja, is about the fake of the age of an athlete. So he cannot go to the competition. He is prohibited to go to join the competition because the organizing committee said that this child is faking the certificate of birth. So we have to do the estimation of age of these children. So he can go for the being to in the group of the athlete that can go to compete. The competition, and as we have examination his age, actually he is concluded in that age, but because the age estimation being produced by not expert in forensics, so they only say that this child is about 19 years old. So actually it's about the average age. We have to do that because we have using so many methods on it. So we have to know that we doing this examination as a whole person. So it cannot be being only for odontologists can guess the age estimation of the person, but the whole. We have to work as a team. So remember, we are there is no competing, the competing of the study itself, but we are using that as a comprehensive way. Thank you.
Yeah, so I like to take one question from Dr. Pooja Puri, madam. She asked about what is your opinion on Sina Vora identification through superimposition? I just want to say that a proper technique is not used. That's why the report is so much contradictory.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Ma'am, question to Dr. Hemalatha, ma'am. In your presentation, you said about many of the radiographs. Radiographs and use of radiographs. Suppose if you have any part of a fragment of a bone,
yes.
And if you find that, and if you go for an investigation, how far this radiological investigation will help in identification?
it's just a fragment of bone, is it?
Yeah, any bone, any part of the human.
So, sir, even if there is...
radiologically.
Yes, yes. So even if there is, we don't have any, specific treatment or any extraordinary finding. Even the normal findings, if we have the radiograph, even those are unique to us. So like on the bones, if you see the trabecular pattern or the sinuses, the shape of the sinuses, all those things make it unique. Even if there is no dental treatment, that will help us in identifying the person. It depends on what kind of data that radiograph has and the quality of the radiograph which is available as well. So it will depend on a case-to-case basis. The more amount of information or the more data or details that radiograph has, the more helpful it will be. It will be of more value to the case. So I guess radiograph is the richest form of information. If we are looking for antemortem information, and if we have a radiograph, it can be the richest form of information if you compare it to the written records or photographs. Radiograph will be more richer in value.
Hello. Hello. Yeah. Can you, Dr. Neeraj Taneja, can you add up in anything about on the radiographs?
As you said, a radiograph is a very crucial evidence and it cannot be tampered with. The only thing is, experts should have the opinion of the expert should be proper with all the scientific basis, so that it can withstand the cross examination in the court of law. Because ultimately, the end is the cross examination. The judge, the honorable judge, accept that evidence as an additional evidence or maybe the crucial evidence or anything. That's up to them. Forensic, as a forensic expert or forensic odontology or forensic radiologist, the important thing is we should know the art of withstanding the cross examination.
Thank you. Question to Dr. Ranjit. In your presentation, you talk about swapping and other, etc. Could you tell about that? What is the type of cameras can be required, and can you highlight about the cameras and the specifications so that we can have the exact thing? So that the photography plays very important in your thing. How it will helps in the end case?
As far as the camera is concerned, see the how the cases we are dealing in Indian scenario or in our scenario for the photo facial recognition. Like there is a one exhibit which is admitted or the submitted to the police authority that this is the person suspected, and another we are receiving through the CCTV or the different kind of camera. So a good quality camera is always preferable with a good megapixel for the CCTV considered either DVR or NVR. Not megapixel will be giving a good result. Even the tools which is standardized like MPET-5 or other tools for the clearing of the photographs so that a person can be easily identified on the basis of his or her facial. So the good quality camera is always required, but the problem is that whatever the CCTV footage or the images we are receiving through the different camera, they are in a very poor quality, number one. Second, they are why the quality is coming down, just because we are not cleaning the cameras regularly. So dust deposition also play a very important role on the CCTV. So these are the, we have a good quality camera, then facial recognition through the images which is captured. Even in many countries, they have a facial recognition database and they make an entry through the just basis of the facial recognition triangulation technique. They have developed a different algorithm, and by that algorithm, they are allowing people to recognize through their facial feature and their different anthropometric markers, and by that that algorithm calculates some indices, and that indices allow the identification of the person.
Thank you, sir. Question to Dr. Hemalatha, madam.
Yes, sir.
In your presentation, can you share some experience on the 3D reconstruction, ma'am?
Sir, can you repeat the question?
See, in your presentation, you spoke about the facial reconstruction, and there are some softwares have been used in the various facial reconstructions. My question is that nowadays 3D reconstruction, because a lot of imaging techniques have come, CT scan, CBCT, and all those things. So 3D reconstruction, can you share your experience on 3D reconstruction?
Yes, sir. Right now, as you said, working in a hospital, it's very advantageous for us because then we don't need scanners and all. We already have those facilities available at the radiology department. So it has become convenient. However, for reconstructing, scanning is not a problem, but for reconstructing the skull, we need softwares, especially if you want to do 3D reconstruction. So these softwares are a little expensive, but these are actually industrial grade softwares. They are used in industries to build machines and to which are measurement accurate. So we are using these softwares, which are quite expensive. You can say around they cost over 30 lakhs. It is difficult to procure right now. However, we have alternatives. Obviously, there are no freely available softwares. You will have to invest. So it requires an administration backing to set up such kind of a lab as well. But yes, we have started working on some cases using this reconstructive techniques. Because we are in the process of setting up a lab. So we are using digital methods for reconstructions. Also, this is a side effect or impact of COVID because the lab has been sealed and we are not allowed to go in the lab for manual reconstruction. So we decided that we will do digital reconstructions now. Okay. So that is why, sir, now we are already working on 3 cases right now. I have 12 cases pending. So we thought we will work on digital reconstructive methods since we are not allowed to go in the lab. The digital reconstruction method in itself is the same. It's just that instead of manually applying the clay with our fingers, we apply it with the help of a software. So you do the same applying of clay, same applying of the tissue depth markers, and applying the based on the database of which region that skeletal remains are from. So we have the database. Normally we apply manually the tissue depth markers, which we apply now on the software, and the manual application of clay for the reconstruction, for building up of the muscles, the soft tissue, fat tissue, salivary glands, all those things, now we do it digitally. So you are basically doing the same process which you used to do manually. It's just that it has gone digital now. So and then you apply the skin and you apply features, the eyes, the nose, and because you are doing a profiling before you do the reconstruction, so you have a profile that this is a male or a female and you know an approximate age range, so you will add facial features based on that age range. So if you think that the skeletal remains, they are belonging to someone who is around 60 years old, you will add some wrinkles and pores and all those things, droopy eyelids and all those things you will add as per the age determination. So as I said, it is not an accurate science. It is a combination of science and art. So a forensic artist also plays a major role along with the anthropologist. So we add those features as per the profiling which we have done. So if it is a tobacco chewer, he has stains, we will add features accordingly. Or if we think he's a smoker or... different things, sir. Age estimate. If we do age estimation, the loose skin and the pores on the skin, all those things will be added. And it is all done on the software, so it is much easier for us. There are several softwares which are available. They are all commercial softwares. They are available for this purpose, along with the 3D reconstruction for texturing of the skin and all those things. So 3D reconstruction in India, it's still, I would say that even globally, it's not done very commonly. There are only few people who are actually doing this work, but there are people who are doing this work in US. In fact, Ranjit sir has organized another webinar on 3rd of May, where Michael Steed, he's a police sketch artist who is doing this work. So he has some experience in the field of forensic artistry, and he does this profiling and reconstructing faces and superimposition and all these things. So he's one of the people who is doing this work. Then we have experts in Germany who are doing, and we know, we saw Amal's webinar last month, I guess, where he talked about this reconstruction. So yes, it is slowly coming into India. And being in a government institute, I have taken upon myself to develop this lab because I feel it is a very necessary in India. I realized this because when I did my couple of, when I did my first four cases and they were cracked because of this, there were cases coming into me from all over India. So it's not just Maharashtra. I got cases from West Bengal. I got cases from Punjab area. I got cases from Himachal. So it is a requirement in India. It's not that if you can do this, then definitely it will be, the police will approach you and they will, you will be able to provide your expertise in this. So definitely if people are interested in this field, they should pursue this. This is something which will be very valuable to the field of forensic science.
Professor Goria sir, there is a one common question: how the things in a forensic after the post lockdown.
Please repeat the question. I am not getting the clear voice.
Yeah, I connected you just because you are the most experienced person. The question is how the things will affect after the how the changes will come in a forensic science after the post lockdown.
I think for this the things are not going to change because it is everything depends upon the law of the country, and when the law of the country will remain the same, the things are going to remain the same. Only the thing is that we will have to take more precautions because we know now that this is a disease which has come and it's going to stay there, and we have to take precautions. The postmortem crime scene investigation is going to remain there, postmortem examination is going to remain there, and the court evidences are going to remain there. So whatsoever I see the changes is that the court evidences part, because they are very much, judges are very much afraid of this disease, and there will be, the witnesses will go as a through teleconferencing.
That sir, is the only, we have already started teleconferencing in Maharashtra.
So that has started probably all over India, and in Punjab also, and in Chandigarh also. It is through teleconferencing that we are giving our opinions. So that is the only change I see, because the postmortem examination is going to remain there. It is a part of the law. The crime scene investigation is going to remain there. But the people, I think, will be taking more precautions at the crime scene investigation. That is only thing which I visualize. Thank you, Dr. Ranjit.
Any other questions is left over, Dr. Ranjit?
Sir, we have covered maximum question. Few questions we have already covered during the session. And I just requested all the international delegations who have joined there, if they want to add anything, they can raise their hand. And I just want to unmute them and they can say something. So there is one raised hand. So I just want to unmute you. Yes, sir. Please go ahead. I think you are muted yourself.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
I have seen some of the chat questions, Ms. Parul. Actually, myself, forensic odontology, I'm from Gujarat, Ahmedabad city. So along with the Commissioner of Police, we have taken the permission and we have sanitized the 44 police stations, including the police inspectors, about the forensic odontology and role of forensic odontology. And after that, I have got some of the cases individually, and they are just consulting. As a consultant, they are calling me and they are asking the sir, which limit can this case can be solved, or whether where we have to take the cases, because they doesn't know whether the tooths which are getting in the crime scene or the teeth which can be used in the age estimations or not. So when I given them about the forensic odontology, they were just surprised about it. So this is I'm doing for the past 2 years. And only one thing problem happened is after the 2 years, they got transferred to the other cities or other states. So gradually there is a decrease in the. So as of now, we said, now I'm getting the cases. But only problem is, as I'm a private forensic odontologist, so my opinion is just like a consultation only. So our report can't be justified in the court of law. So anything can anyone add up?
Yes, sir. That?
Can you help me?
If you are helping a practitioner and they are taking your help as an officially, so they can take a permission from the DG or their state home ministry to appoint you as an expert on the panel. Because I'm working in several cases of the government as an expert panel where my report is going from the side of prosecutions. So you can guide your state, whoever the IPS officer is heading, they can take a permission from the higher authority and they can appoint you on the panel as per my knowledge.
Okay. And so one thing this.
Yes, I would like to add here that when you have a degree and dental degree, and I don't know whether you have it or not, but if you have it and you are a registered dental practitioner, then in any case, you are free to give your opinions, and that will be acceptable in the court as far as it is the clinical forensic medicine is concerned. Clinical forensic medicine means it is the age determination, or it may be bite marks on the living person. So in those cases, your opinion will be considered. But as far as the postmortem cases are concerned, then in those cases, only the government doctors who are authorized to do this examination, their opinions are considered. So as far as clinical cases are concerned, your opinion will be considered if you have got a BDS degree.
So any other?
So
myself,
sir,
I think Thank we you, have sir. Covered so many questions and everything, and we have clarified many of the doubts. I think before we conclude, sir, I request Gorya sir to say one carry-on message to everyone, sir.
All my dear friends who are part of this webinar, and all the speakers, Dr. Neeraj, Dr. Hemlata, Dr. Evi, Dr. Ranjit Singh, and Professor Emilio, who has just left us, and the organizers, Dr. Sunil and Dr. Neeraj Taneja, and all the persons who have been helping you in this process, and your especially the your seniors in the university, I convey my thanks to all of them that they have done this wonderful webinar, and where I think more than 500 participants have been there, and all of them have beautiful lectures delivered by the eminent experts in this area, and it was a very good experience, and probably by this you must be enthused about the forensic odontology. And now you should think of that how you have to carry this in future. Probably I will suggest that you be part of the Indo-Pacific Academy of Forensic Odontology, where you will have many like-minded people with whom you can discuss and you can carry on forward. So once again, I congratulate all the speakers. I congratulate the organizers and Tirthankar Mahavir University, its vice chancellors and chancellors, and other respectable members of that university who have been part of this and who have offered all their help in doing this webinar in a very successful manner. So I thank all the speakers, I thank everybody, and I thank all the listeners who have been part of this, and we feel very honored and we feel very pleased, and I congratulate everybody and thank everybody, and I say you join INPAHU and raise its standards because you are the future generation who are going to carry this organization forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So there is one thing to add. We have many questions related to when we are going to organize the next of the lecture. So I just want to say this is the beginning of 2.0. So just wait, you will receive the email about the 2.0.
Yes, thank very you. Soon. Before I conclude, I'd like to thank all the speakers, Dr. Emilio and Dr. Evi, Dr. Hemlata Pandey, Dr. Neeraj Taneja, Ranjit Singh, for their kind support and help And I also thanks to my university and my college, as well as my chancellor, sir, Suresh Jain, and vice chairman, sir, Dr. Mr. Manish Jain, and our principal, Dr. Manish Goyal, sir, our vice chancellor who supported us, Dr. Raghuveer Singh, sir, and our joint register, Dr. Aditya Sharma, sir, who are all helped me in organizing this event. And a very much special thanks to Dr. Neera Taneja and Dr. Ranjit Singh for their continuous support in helping in our in all the speakers, and they helped me a lot. And I think Dr. Ranjit has taken a lot of painful in organizing this event and everything. And from the organizing committee, I giving a special thanks to you as well as Dr. Neeraj for helping out all those things. Thank you so much. And at the last, I thank to my strength and my team is my faculty, Dr. Ravindra, Dr. Upender, Dr. Rupika, Dr. Akip, and Dr. Gatima, Dr. Ajali, and Dr. Shilpi, and my postgraduate students who supported me in all this event. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye, everybody. Bye, everybody.